Hi, I'm Michael.
I'm Alex.
At Pride Roofing, we handle commercial and residential work.
TPO, shingle and metal inventory,
we got it.
Property still in disarray from the recent hurricanes and hailstorms?
Insurance claims?
No problem.
Call 855-PRIDE16. Se habla Espanol.
We're back at the school board central office where there's a lot to talk about. The keynote today is uniforms. A survey is back showing ditching the uniform dress code policy would be a very popular thing to do. One person who's looking at it with great interest is Brett Duncan, the school board president. So is it a slam dunk that uniforms are about to be a thing of the past?
Well, I wouldn't say that, Ken. I think that the survey results that came back definitely provided a lot of good information. We're, of course, going to be taking additional input from in a number of other ways as well. And really, you know, what the survey came back, I think, what it really is saying is that we need to be open to some adjustments. I don't know that it's completely clear as far as what exactly those adjustments are, but there seems to be consensus that what we're currently doing is not working. It's not enforced with a lot of consistency, and that it oftentimes is creating more distractions than or problems than it's helping.
Well, on the other hand, you know, what if another incident occurs that makes us all more security conscious?
Yeah, and there's certainly an argument that the uniforms would help with security. I think there's some other ways to address that. And I don't know that the uniforms in and of themselves really address security concerns. But those are all good conversations to have. It's going to, like I said, we still have a long way to go before there's any sort of decision on what next year is going to look like as far as the dress code is concerned.
Are you surprised at the survey results?
Not really. I mean, I certainly knew that that the students, the high school students in particular, were gonna want to have something less restrictive than what we currently have. I was a little surprised that the parents were also pretty lopsided. And then, we broke it down as also amongst administrators and then by grade levels. So some of those results were a little bit surprising, but not anything, terribly out of the ordinary.
You know, I seem to feel that when you talk about uniforms, we should follow it up with talking about fights on campus, because the two major controversies you've dealt with for the last year, they're always hand in hand. Anything new on the discipline policy?
Well, that is, you're right. It is that time of the year where we also, in addition to reevaluating the uniform policy, we also, always want to look back and look at ways that we can improve our discipline policy. So that will be part of the discussion as well in the months ahead. And there were a lot of changes at the beginning of this last school year and over the course of the school year. Trying to find the right balance there. So I'm sure that we'll be doing some additional tinkering in that area as well.
So it just seems, looking at the statistics, and I always go to the docket of the 7th Ward Court to look, I mean, fighting may be down a little bit, it's still a perennial problem.
It's I think it has improved significantly the more that we took a heavy hand with it. I do think that those things go hand in hand, that the more that the message was delivered that, fighting on our campuses is not going to be tolerated, that there are going to be substantial consequences, that you could face criminal prosecution, the more that we moved those students over to the alternative campus as that campus became available, things did improve. And so to me, that's the data that we would need to be looking at when we talk about what we're going to be doing going forward.
The very fact that so many of these cases wind up in the court system shows that these offenders, they're being arrested, they're being put in jail in some cases. I mean, that's pretty obvious. That's a pretty heavy hand.
Yeah, and like I said, because we just can't tolerate it on our campuses. The message has to be delivered that if you're creating a disturbance on our campus, if you're going to be messing up education for the other students on our campuses, there's going to be severe consequences for that. And if it's a serious enough offense, then it means that you will be referred to juvenile court.
And for those who think the alternative school is some kind of a Botany Bay where you put all the bad guys, boy, you've invested a tremendous amount of money in that school.
Well, we have, because, look, we recognize that just because you make a mistake or because there was some sort of problem that resulted in you having to be removed from a regular school environment, that doesn't mean we're giving up on you. That means that we want to find the right fit for you. We want to find the resources that you need. We want to address those things. And then ultimately, once you've demonstrated that you can come back to a regular school environment, we want to send you back there, and we want you to be set up for success.
A lot of people don't realize this, but the Juvenile Detention Center is actually a Tangipahoa school campus. And I heard a statistic today from Joey Dominic that blows me away. They've had 75 students in their in-house program where they're actually the last stop for a kid, not just an intermediary stop. Of 75, only two reoffended. That's about the best recidivism rate you could imagine.
Yeah, look, that sounds great. And by the way, I absolutely support the renewal of that tax. I hope everybody gets out there and supports that in the upcoming weekend. And early voting is going on right now. So hopefully that tax will get renewed for the detention center. But look, there's a lot of things that we do know as far as best practices when it comes to young people who are committing these offenses. And one of those things that we do know that is best practices is we've got to take it serious. There's got to be consequences for bad behavior. But ultimately, we also want to work with them, rehabilitate them, and try to set them up for success in the future. At the age group that we're talking about, it's way too early to just give up on kids.
But Joey would give credit to the Tangipahoa school system, so take a little bit of a victory lap that apparently we're learning how to rehabilitate kids in trouble.
Yeah, absolutely. I think they are a great partner with us, and I think we're a great partner for the detention center.
Well, another item on the agenda will be a discussion of the school board building program, which, let's just be honest, in recent months has been slowed down by a lot of unforeseen circumstances. But nevertheless, you've got a lot of progress going on and a lot more to come.
Yeah, look, we're in kind of it's kind of a strange circumstance for our school system because we do have so many building projects that are all going on at once. And so part of what we're going to be doing tonight is we want to kind of check in on where the administration stands on all of these various projects. We want to make sure that they are moving along at a pace that we hope that they would be. We want to see if there's anything the board can do to help the administration move things along, any of those types of things. But we do have a tremendous amount of building projects that are ongoing, from huge phase two construction projects that are in the 10 to $15 million range to small roofing projects, IDA repairs that are still going on. We have some air conditioning projects that have been kind of on standby for a while, and we're trying to see if we can't get those moving along. And then, of course, a whole host of just smaller projects as well. So just a tremendous amount.
What else do you want to share with us?
Well, we're looking, this is that time of the year where we get to kind of recognize all of the great accomplishments of our graduating seniors or our athletes. And so tonight there'll be a lot on the agenda, recognizing our state championship basketball team over in Ponchatoula, the runners-up over in A Meet. All of the students that scored high on the ACT, we'll be bringing those in. Some music and talented choir folks that are going to be recognized. So it's that time of year, and we all love to bring those in and just recognize all of the great students that we do have within our system.
Italian food is made with lots of love. I'm Tickball Italian Festival Queen Claire Edwards welcoming you to come eat with us this weekend.
And I'm Donna Miller, this year's Spaghetti Queen. You're in for 3 days of delicious Italian food, great music, and fun for the whole family.
I'm Robbie Miller, Italian Festival King, and with this kind of Italian food and great fun, you'll see why we're the best parish in the state.
Hi, Frank Selfo, Grand Marshal, inviting everyone to Tickball for the Italian Festival.
You're gonna love it!